Yes. Hello there.
Hi.
How's everything?
Baruch Hashem, okay.
Why is there no video? Here I am.
Dave is going to be joining us from a different location.
Dave? Dave's not here. Is that the
Dave's on. We've used that line before.
Hi.
Dave will be here shortly. There, let
Yeah.
me minimize some screen. How's everybody? Is having a pleasant Memorial Day weekend in the United States? Meaningful, hot, smoky.
I'm not in the States.
That's right. I'm sorry. I should
Notice the background.
recognize your background. I can see that out my window almost.
I have the perfect view of all the explosions on Heart Their Own.
All the activity,
Oh, all the fun, all the fun.
all the fun.
Yes.
Ugh.
Today I was my wife went to babysit my youngest daughter's son, and she was on the train to Tel Aviv when all the rockets were landing.
Oh.
It goes to show that we should go into Rafiach, and we should, I'll keep my a lot of what I think.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes. It's good to have an opinion. Okay. We just have to be mindful of the forum in which we share it.
It's so interesting. We're, it's 237. But 236 days we're at war.
Too dang long, frankly.
No, but this is war. mean, I had experience 40 years of reserve duty in the United and IDF, so I mean, like, I'm handicapped also because of it.
I believe, hello Yaakov and Nish and Miri, I believe we are in Rafiach already. We go in and we go in and out, but we're in. Thanks.
Going in, going out, going in.
That's not a star strategy. That's a very poor strategy.
You're telling me, kid. Been there, done that.
It shouldn't be that way.
Exactly. In my humble opinion, I would have made a nice new parking lot out of the area.
Stop. That would be a good idea.
I
Better than
mean, if we look at looking in hindsight, we've lost 700 young men.
well, let's not talk about that.
Well, we need to because of the simple reason that we should have from the very beginning. We, I served, I was telling Mary, I served for almost 40 years in the Israeli army, and mostly in reserve, and served in Lebanon. I was injured three times from IEDs, and I was a combat medic. And to tell you the truth, this one hair on one soldier is not worth all of Gaza.
Absolutely.
Agreed. Hey, Yaakov, thank you very much for your comments. I mean that sincerely because you know me, I think, well enough. Dave and Adele have joined us, so I'm going to ask everybody to please put themselves on mute, and I'm going to be the technical producer, so to speak. I'll be monitoring the messages. Dave's joining us from a remote location. He's going to tell us all about it in a minute, but I'm going to hand the floor over to Dave and Idell. So thanks very much, everybody, for joining
Hi,
us.
Mary, and thank you very much. I love your bees graffiti on the back.
Be sweet.
Hey, Adele.
Hi, everybody. By the way, Mary, I love your
Nishika.
yes. Thank you very much. It's wonderful. Anybody who needs something really, really good for the lips, David.
Be kissable.
Nishikalipam. So, Mary, you're recording it and you're going to upload it afterwards?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. So, Dave, what are we looking at here?
Okay, here we go. Just flipping back and forth. I'm out in the field at the refugee protest camp. At the moment, people are still arriving. There's going to be a bonfire here tonight for Lag BaOmer, for the holiday of Lag BaOmer, where it's customary to do that. In the background, behind where the people you see in front of us is Tzfat, the eastern side of Tzfat. There have been a lot of jets and helicopters going over in the last half hour. There's been a tremendous barrage into border communities in the northern Galilee, which essentially is directly north of where we're standing. And in fact, I was on the phone to have a guest on, the chief of the group, 1701. It's a lobbying group for the northern residents. And he was under the siren went off just as we were on the phone in the car. And he's in the security team from his kibbutz, Kfar Giladi. So we had to hang up and take care of the incoming rocket or drone. He wasn't able to get back to me, and I hope he's well. It's been a very, very loud, dangerous, noisy 24 hours here in the north, and of course in central Israel. There was a barrage of about 8 to 12 rockets, depending on reports, into central Tel Aviv and the Gush Dan region. So a lot of people were running for cover. There was one woman, I believe, or a young woman that was injured from shrapnel, from falling debris. Beyond that, I don't know of other injuries. There may have been some damage as well, but everything is moving very quickly around here. So here we are. We're in a field at an intersection along a major highway here. And I'm going to turn the camera around here, and you'll see some of the people that are arriving here. You see the tents there in the background.
And what are these people protesting, Dave?
Well, they're protesting essentially. They feel left out of what's going on here in the north. They feel that they've been abandoned to no small degree, and that the government has not provided them with solutions or goal and living circumstances for 80 to 100,000 internal refugees and thousands and tens of thousands more of refugees who are still in their villages, in their communities. Not everybody was evacuated. Anyone over a 5 kilometer distance from the border strip along the border is remaining in their towns and villages. And so they're all living under this threat 24/7. And
as compared to people in the South?
I don't know if it's a contrast and compare. I don't think it's a contest. People in the South.
It's not a contest, but it's an issue of we were in a different situation, in as much as we were attacked physically, we were infiltrated. And immediately when October 7th happened and we were evacuated, many, many people in the North were also evacuated. So when I was in the hotel down in Eilat, there were people from Kiryat Shmona and other places that were in the hotel. Now we moved out these apartments in February. I don't know where those people from Kiryat Shmona are, and they are in my mind and in my heart.
Some of them are here. Ah, Aaron Gamzu, there's a man who can speak exactly to the circumstances. Thank you for joining us. Aaron Gamzu is from Kfar Zold. It is a kibbutz in the northern Galilee panhandle, and he's been under tremendous rocket bombardment much of the day. Aaron, over to you.
Wait, one second, please. I just want to finish something that I started saying. We were evacuated because of physical infiltration. They evacuated them up north because they were concerned that they were going to do the same thing.
Correct. So
they evacuated them before something similar could happen. And that still is actually a concern, certainly in the north and other borders on Israel. So that was what I wanted to say. So Aaron, thank you.
Yeah.
Welcome to Life on the Border.
Hey, so yeah, as was said, I live in a kibbutz, which is 5.3 kilometers from the border, Lebanon border. Kfar Zold. And to answer your question, in the south, they decided to evacuate villages, which are up to 7 kilometers from the border. And over here, only 3.5. And some of those which are up to 5 kilometers in my area, for example. So basically, if you are 3.51 from the border, you need to stay in your village and you don't receive any support from the government. Any support. I mean, they decided your village is considered like similar to Tel Aviv. And we tried a lot. I attended several committees in the parliament, and we tried to convince the ones who decided that it is safe to stay over here, but they are not convinced. Our basic civil rights are being violated. It means our kids that don't get almost any education. It is not safe to be here. I live near the main city over here. It is Kiryat Shmona, as you said. And since it was evacuated, so we are left alone. There are no banks. Nothing that you can imagine.
Please mute yourself, Dave. Or maybe mute Dave. I don't have control. Sorry.
Yeah, we also have, we reported to the Supreme Court, and they decided that the government must provide some kind of a solution for us. But, you know, nothing happened since then. So people like me, at the beginning, as you said, it was 7 October, 8 of October, based on some, the army recommended the local council that they will tell us, okay, you need to go, you need to leave up to 9 kilometers. So around 80% of the population over here, you put something in your car and that's it. You drive away. I mean, with the feeling that you are the next one. Eventually, after a few weeks, there was the evacuation decision. As I said, it called 9475, and suddenly we understood that okay, we are not included. I mean, we were out there in all over the country, but okay, no support from the government. We don't receive money. We don't receive anything. No hotels, nothing. So with the time, people started, coming back. I mean, because it costs a lot, living outside your house. Basically, you don't have a house. I'm one of those that decided to stay outside my house. So for the last 7.5 months, I'm renting an apartment, me and my family, in the center. And I can share that the cost, it is around $3,000 per month, something like that, if you take into consideration all the costs that we have. And it is frustrating that we are really, I mean, we are trying, to, I don't want to say convince, to explain that, the basic civil rights, we don't get those. And
so I have a couple of questions for you.
Yeah, sure.
So you said that your kids aren't getting any education. I'd like you to explain that. Yeah. Two, do your homes have safe rooms? And three, did your kibbutz evacuate to a place together?
Okay, so first, I said no education. It means if you go back to the kibbutz, which is by the government, it is considered as safe. In this area, in the Upper Galilee, there are schools. But, first grade, second grade, third grade, they learn together with one teacher. 4 hours a day, 3 hours a day, 4 days in a week. So it's not real school.
Because there are so few children that stayed behind.
Because the entire area.
To understand, it's not that it's usually like that, but because so many families evacuated, there's so few kids left behind that they put first and third grade.
I can give you an example. I mean, my daughter, she goes to school, which is in a village that got evacuated. This school serves six villages. Five of them got evacuated. You can imagine who is the sixth one. So we were left without any school for 3 months. I mean, the parents, they were the teachers. Then they opened a school, but again, there are no teachers in this area because all of them got evacuated. So it's like, you know, there is almost nothing in this area. Also, you know, if you have, there are no stores, nothing. But the people are forced to stay here because when they decided to evacuate, I mean, the evacuation decision, it says that if you cannot provide basic services to this, to those communities, to those villages, you need to evacuate those. But, you know, it is based on civil rights and not something that the army can decide. So they just ignore this line and that's it. I mean, the fact that there is nothing over here, they don't care. They then go, you ask whether there are safe rooms over here. So around 80% of the houses over here, they don't have any safe room. Okay. And also, what is very important to say, you know, we have 0 seconds when there is a siren. It means you hear the bomb, and then there is the siren. So you know when you hear it, you just need to lay down and hope for the best. This is how it goes.
Your kibbutz is in a situation like we were in back in 2009. With the situation of evacuating and everything. This is what we went through in 2009. Did your kibbutz evacuate to a place together?
No, there was no evacuation for my kibbutz based on the government decision.
There was no evacuation for kibbutz Nirim. Before 2009 already, we had plans. We had set up with Mishmar HaEmek that if we need to evacuate, we evacuated ourselves for many years. So what I'm asking is, I would have thought that in the kibbutz movement, there would have been some help that you get from the kibbutz movement to evacuate yourselves to someplace together.
So it's a very good point. Thank you for raising it. So I can tell you that in the past, there were plans like this one. That, okay, if you will need to evacuate the kibbutz, where you need to go. But based on the government and the army decision, they told us, look, it will never happen. So, okay. So those kibbutzes, I mean, the one that needs to evacuate and the one that needs to receive all the people, they said, okay, there is no need for this plan anymore. So basically what happened on the October 7th, that you just took your car and drove wherever you can. And that's it.
Mm-hmm. Kibbutz not gotten together to talk about it, to make a different plan, to...
So it was so difficult. I mean, there was... because imagine that there were like 100,000 people that got evacuated from this area. So, you know, people, other kibbutzes, they had some kind of arrangements. Since we didn't, doing it after, let's say, 2-3 weeks, it was already, you know, after the fact.
Hmm.
And, I mean, that's it. I mean, people, they went to the south, to the center, I mean, not far away from here. I mean, all over the country. And you know that, and since you know we are a community, so imagine the kids. I mean, they were left alone without any friends. Living out there, I live now in Holland, and all my kids, the friends, all of them are new.
They're in school in Holland.
Yes, yes. And you know, for kids, it is horrible. I mean, they want their friends. I mean, they, since, you know, they were born there with them.
Yeah, so that's from time to it's not about learning anything from the teacher. The main thing is being with your friends.
Yeah, yeah.
I was a teacher for 38 years. I know that. I know it.
Yeah, you know. So, yeah.
Apropos teacher, Elizabeth is on this call, and she says she's a teacher in the States, and she's willing to volunteer time and tutor for free this summer. She teaches 9 to 10-year-olds. So if you think that would be helpful in any way, you're welcome to reach out to each other and give each other. Elizabeth, if you send me your contact, I can get it to Dave. That's very sweet.
Yeah, sure. You know, it's you know what you just said, because you know, most of the people, they don't know that there are people in my situation. I mean, that live like 3.5 kilometers from the border and they get nothing. And the kids are, you know, in a disaster mode, really. And, you know, when you have good people that they want to volunteer or to give money or anything, they're not aware that there is a problem also with my community. They only know that there are people that got evacuated from their house. They don't know that there are people that are forced to stay in their villages because they don't receive any support from the government. So usually when, you know, there are people that they gave their apartments, that they, you know, gave some presents, they gave money, we were left out of it.
And where's the Tnoa Kibbutzit? Where's the kibbutz movement? They've helped so many kibbutzim. Where are they with your kibbutz?
So they are busy with too many things, I would say. And we are like the third priority or something like that. And they are trying to help, but it's, you know, they have the people that are, you know, kidnapped to Gaza, and they have all the people that got evacuated from their home. And we are like number three. I can tell you something good that happened. It is where Dave is currently located. So we, the group that I represent, and other groups. So, you know, we have like a united group now. And this is how we have this camp over there. I mean, it is a joint effort from all of us. Saying, okay, there is no difference. We all represent the north of Israel, and we are in a disaster. And we need to come, and we come together and ask, really, help us. Help us. We cannot live like this. And we hope, you know, that someone will listen. I mean, tomorrow the government, they need to decide about the plan that they have for the North tomorrow. And we read the plan. And it is like, I don't know, maybe it is related to another country, but not to Israel. There is no real solution to any of the major issues. For example, in September 1st, you need to start, you know, school. My kids, they need to start school over here, or kindergarten, or whatever. There is no solution for this problem. Nothing. And like, we need to decide what to do. We need to come back. We need to stay. What to tell the kids? You know, the basic thing, the kids, they ask me, okay, where will I go next year? I don't know.
Yeah, we don't know where we're enrolling our kids either.
Yeah.
So, Aaron, what do you suggest? I understand the problem. What do you suggest that we can do to make this happen more properly?
You or the government?
Well, you're talking to us. Can we influence the government? Do you mean Hafganot? Yeah. What do you mean?
Yeah, they need to understand our situation. I mean, it's not, it's, I mean.
Realize
I mean,
who the government is. They ain't gonna understand your situation. They're sitting there. So far, they haven't.
So we are going there. I mean, Tuesday is going to be my 15th time that I'm going, you know, to one of the parliament committees. And, you know, we meet with people from the parliament. Most of them, they understand the situation. But the government, they insist that, you know, that we don't exist.
Yeah, welcome to the world.
They've
been that way. They've been that way ever since. For years.
You know, but even the Supreme Court, they told the government, okay, you need to have a plan for those villagers. You need to support them. So they keep on saying, yeah, we have some kind of a plan, which is totally inaccurate.
And I'd like you know, to bring,
I'd
like to bring in as well someone else to the discussion here. Tikva Sasson, who lives in Maalot, is with us, or at least she was with us, and they've been under a lot of... Are you there?
Yeah. Do you see me?
Okay, we sure do now. Can you give us just another point of view from how you see it? You're up along the hard up against the border as well in the Western Galilee.
Right.
How are you managing, you and your husband and family? You've got children in green as well.
Yes. Okay. So thank God we're fine. We live approximately 7 kilometers from the border, but we live on the hill and our house faces north. So we get to see a lot of daily activity and hear a ton of daily activity. There's way more going on up here than what anybody talks about in the news. And I think that they're just kind of trying to downplay it, because there's a lot going on. So our youngest is in the army. His base was Berenice. Berenice only
Don't name locations. Don't name locations or anything specific.
No locations. Okay, well, they had to move their base because it's only Kravi there now because it's on the border. So supposedly there's supposed to be plans for taking care of this problem, but it's slow, and I think everybody's just really worried that everything is so slow. Like the other man said, school for young children is only half days. Like I have girls living in Moshav Achiud, and their kids, they don't go to school the whole day. I mean, this is like a whole year of, like, I have a granddaughter in first grade. And she doesn't go to school the whole day. She only goes to school part of a day, even though she goes to school all the way down in Moshav Regba, which is near Akko. It's still only a half day of school. And so it's really disconcerting how many children are getting only a partial day of school. And it's also really disconcerting the amount of incoming bombs and other things that come in, and it's not talked about in the news. They only say when there's an azaka, when there's a red alert. That's the only time they say anything. But I can tell you that there's a lot more that goes on than what you hear in the official announcements. So hopefully this will be cleaned up soon. I mean, I'm hopeful it's going to be cleaned up soon, because, you know, we need our security buffer zone desperately.
When you say a buffer zone, can you explain that briefly for people who are abroad? They don't know who's buffering against who. At the moment, there's a 3 to 5 kilometer buffer zone within Israel. You're saying that buffer zone needs to be within Lebanon, correct?
Exactly. You know, we had the UN resolution 1701 that was supposed to keep Hezbollah, Amal Shia,
where I am,
and everything else off of our border. Now, the UN, we see in multiple places, is just an utter failure. You would almost consider it the Muslim terrorist organization instead of the United Nations. It's an absolute absurdity. And it's just shocking, you know? You know, I'm 55 years old, and as a small child, you know, I'm thinking, oh, the United Nations, what a nice thing, right? But who are they now, and what are they doing, and what is their priorities? So yeah, I mean,
just
answer
a security buffer zone in the north that is not ours, that it belongs to Lebanon.
What is most, this is the first time I've been on this group. Are most of the people in Chutzlars abroad or in Israel? What?
Adele, you want to jump in?
No, sorry, I wasn't listening. I was writing.
I asked, are most of the people here residents of Israel or America?
Most of the people here on this call?
Yes.
Okay, everybody who lives in America who's on this call is invited to raise their hands and reactions. Click on reactions and click raise hand. Oh, okay, if you could do it on, if you're on camera, you could raise your hands. If you're not on camera, you can click the raise hand thing. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4. I don't know where Shelly is. And I don't know where Belle is, and they're not raising their hands. And Valerie, did you raise your hand?
Belle's here.
I just want to tell you the reason I'm asking, because those of us who live here are aware of all of this, I assume. If you're living and breathing, you're watching the news, you're reading the news, you know what's happening, you have children in the army, you know. But if you're in America, I assume you don't know. So what can we do here and what can you do there? I believe that perhaps as Americans, you could do a lot of PR work, large. Maybe we can take out advertisements in the friendly New York Times saying what's going on in big letters, people who write well could bring it to the American public. And those who live here, maybe we have to be doing something else. As far as helping the children, we know the problem with the children. Everybody knows it. But for example, I have a brother in America who's willing to volunteer to tutor. Give me an address, someone who could take care of it. Someone in Shlomi, someone in Metula, someone here. Just so that we could organize. We all know that it's a lousy situation. We have to do something to get it better. That's my opinion, sorry.
I'd like to jump in if I can. Aaron, if you could just hold for a moment. We have with us Professor Yahel Groner.
Colander,
okay. And Yahel is going to, she's here at the group. And if you could tell us briefly what this group is about here, what's happening here at this protest camp.
I would just say that, hi, my name is Yahel, and I'm a single mother of two, and I've been away from my home for more than 8 months. My children, one is in 13 years old and the other one is 16. They already changed 3 schools and 4 houses. And you can just imagine the crisis that we are dealing emotionally and physically. This is like, our entire community is away in the country. Now, we have been, I've been an activist all my life in all kinds of issues. But since this specific crisis, which is the largest one in Israel for my community and my life.
Where are you from?
I'm from Bet Hillel. Bet Hillel, yeah, that's next to Kiryat Shmona.
Several times a day.
Just today, 50 rockets, actually, at the area of the Upper Galil. My parents stayed in the farm. We have cows and we have all kinds of plants. They stayed because two of my brothers who works in the farm, they've been in the army since 7 October. So it's just them and the migrant workers trying to handle the farm. And because I have the children, I went away, but I'm still coming and going to this area to take care of my parents. And we just discovered, like everyone else, that they've been away. We've been alone, and the government is not functioning in anything. I mean, we are just stayed alone in education means and in also in health means, and we have to take care of ourselves. So we managed to make all kind of connection between different groups. Also 1701, but also all different. I'm coming from the group which is activist against the government, against Netanyahu. But we joined ourselves. You know, everybody puts aside a little bit of his, his political, and we are trying to take control of our life, take back the control of our life, and try to make a non-violent, of course, legal activist activations just to try to come back home. We want to go home, but we want to go home safe. We don't want to be the next kidnappers.
What do you want had to happen with Lebanon with Hezbollah in Lebanon?
Obviously, I'm not a military person, but I know for sure that we have been aware of the circumstances in the Lebanon border for quite a while. And actually, just before the war, for us in Beit Hillel, we had protocol, evacuation protocols, because we knew that the minute something will happen, some rocket, we have to go. So actually, Beit Hillel, as a community, in the 7th of October morning, we just, everybody escaped. We didn't wait for the government to handle us. We didn't wait for anything. But now there are people over there, and they are, I mean, we have a strong army, and you know, everybody's, you know, all the money goes to there. And I want to see 1701 position also taken to go to the Litani, but I also want to know what is happening with Hezbollah, what is happening with the Redouan, because I do not want my face to be on posters as the next kidnapper. Person who kidnapped, and I know this is in my future if nothing will happen.
Thank you very much. You. Okay, Adele, I'm going to throw it back to you.
Does Yaakov want to say something? Yaakov's been, we've got 3.5 minutes left, according to the timer on top, Miri. That's what I see anyway. I need a minute at the end. Yaakov, do you want to say something? Is he still here? Oh, yes, he is. Yaakov.
Yeah, the thing is like this. I've had experience in Lebanon since 1978 when I went in, Mifsa Latani. I served in Lebanon during the first war in Lebanon, and I went through 3 IEDs. I know the price that we paid for this. And to say that 1701, the UN resolution, supposedly there's supposed to be a UN force, peacekeeper. And they're just sitting on their asses doing absolutely nothing. These Hezbollah people are acting right next to them. And Adele, just like you said, there were tunnels dug into Israel that were discovered that people seem to forget. Prior to the attack on October 7th against you in the Gaza envelope, we were told that we were going to be on the target. And they found all these tunnels coming into Israel. I served not only in the army, but also in the police here as a voluntary policeman. And I know that there were complaints day in, day out by people who live in Shtula, in Shomera, in all these places along the border. They could hear digging from underneath their homes. Now, the government has done absolutely nothing. And I can agree with that. What Aaron and everyone else, we live, okay? Before the Iron Dome, it was incredible to live here. 2006, we had 1,860 rockets land within 5 kilometers of my house. 6 of them landed 50 meters from my house. I have shrapnel that I can show you that was in the side of my home from rockets. I sat here through Messenger talking to people at the New York Times when in the middle of an air raid siren, okay? So I know what it's like to be here under the rocket attack, like what you guys suffered. It was horrific. It was totally horrific what you guys went through. And it could have been prevented if people had paid attention. But it was just like the October War, the Yom Kippur War. All the warnings were there. All the things were there. But once more, people were asleep.
Thank you so much, Yaakov. Okay. We've got less than a minute left. I want to thank Miri for helping us out here.
Thank you.
I want to thank Dave for being out in the field, and I want to thank everybody for coming.
Thank
here.
Aaron and Dr. Yehiel.
Of course, Dr. Yehiel and Aaron, thank
for coming
you
coming on.
And Yaakov. And I want to invite everybody to come next Sunday. I'm inviting Moran from the Commando Hasbara, there is this system that you could do on your smartphone or on the computer that can help us get the word out there. So please be sure and join us next week. I'll be putting up a poster about it. Thank you, everybody. Have a good, safe.
Everybody.
Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for being with us. It really means
appreciate
a lot.
Thank you.